afternoon, everyone. On behalf of the Board of Trustees, Bartholomew County Public Library, and the entire library staff, we welcome you to this special event, the open house and dedication ceremonies for the new Hope Branch of the Bartholomew County Public Library. We want to give a special welcome to members of the Hope Town Council. Seated here to my left are members of the Hope Town Council, and to members of the Flat Rock Hawk Creek School Board, seated here to my right, as well as Superintendent Dr. Kevin Caress. Very pleased that you could join us for this special occasion. I want to give a special thanks to the Ladies Flute Trio, Hauser students Brandy Burke, Mindy Mathis, and Tina Elmore, under the direction of Jeff Colvin. At this time, Reverend David Rockhill, pastor of the Hope United Methodist Church, will come and lead us in our invocation.
Let us pray. O God, we thank you for your gifts to us of knowledge, beauty, and love. We know that in pursuing these things, we are really seeking after you, and in finding these things, we stand in your divine presence. Reveal yourself to us in this place, today and all the days tomorrow. Through Christ we pray. Amen.
At this time, I'd like to introduce to you the president of our Library Board of Trustees, Judith Jones.
Judith. Thank you for all coming. On a hot day like this, we're really excited about this, and it's wonderful to see so many of you here. I'd like to introduce to you the board members of the Bartholomew County Public Library. I'm going to start over on my left. Frank Jerome with the patriotic tie on, and Beth Stroh, Nita Spink. And on my right, I'd like to introduce Marvin Finke, Marvin in the striped shirt, and Gladys Simmons. We have a couple of former board members that were part of this project that are in the audience. Rachel Stoner, I'd like for her to stand up, and Herschel Crippen. Thanks for being here. Also, Tom Bigley is our legal counsel and for the board, and I think Tom's here someplace. There he is. Thanks, Tom. Our administrators of the library are Steve Succo down on the right, another patriotic tie on, and Beth Booth-Poor, who's our assistant director. And then we have our branch manager of Hope, Karen Holman Brown, down in the front row, and Tanny Rodenbeck. And we also would like to mention that we have two former managers here, Imogene Emmert, who was a manager back in the 1970s, 80s, and also Catherine Stafford, who was here in the late 1960s and early 70s, I believe. Catherine, I don't know where you are. Oh, right here, down in front row. The board appreciates the way that all of the staff, all that are up here, our administrators and the staff, the Hope, and our main library people have worked together on this, on every detail of this project to make it a great facility for Hope and for Bartholomew County. We also have a couple of the main staff people here. I'd like for them to stand. I think we've got maybe four or five from the main library. Would they stand, please? Good. They all have worked hard on getting this all put together, too. And we really appreciate all the hard work all of you have done. It was the desire of the board to use as many local contractors as possible in building this library, and we were extremely pleased with Rep and Munt, who were the general contractors. Also, other local contractors were Nading Mechanical, Haddon Engineering, Southern Indiana Millwork, and Dan Cook Creative Landscaping. Thank you all for your part in this library. I'd like to introduce to you Stephen Brockman, an architect. He's right over here. with Deborah Berke from New York, and thank you, Stephen, for your help and your input in this project. Now, it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you Deborah Berke, the architect for the Hope Ranch Library, and her sweet daughter, Tess, that came all the way from New York, who has literally, Tess is actually literally growing up during the process of building this library. We've been able to see Tess' pictures as Deborah has come and worked with us. Deborah came to our attention through the Cummins Engine Foundation. She was selected by the board after we interviewed several other firms. Her presentation and the scope of her work impressed us, and we have not been disappointed with the end product. Deborah, you've been delightful to work for and work with, and we appreciate your patience in listening to all of our ideas and suggestions, and your willingness and your flexibility to incorporate all of our wishes in your design. Deborah began practicing architecture in 1982 after graduating from Rhode Island School of Design, and her first significant work was in 1984 down in Seaside, Florida, in a prototype community where she designed several houses and several buildings. She's presently in practice in New York City and is a professor of architecture at Yale University. Her most recent work is the prototype for Calvin Klein Space CK Stores and the Battery City Park headquarters in Lower Manhattan, as well as she's working on a $10 million project renovation at Yale University right now. Other information about Deborah is available in the library, and you may want to, there's a brochure on the circulation desk you might like to look at. Rather than listing more of her many accomplishments, I know you'll enjoy hearing her thoughts now about the development of the Hope Ranch Library.
Thank you very much, and good afternoon, hot afternoon. When I spoke with Judy last week, we agreed that the most interesting thing I could probably talk about today would be the process that led to this design. I'll make my talk much briefer than the process itself was. I first came to Hope about 4 years ago when Tess was an infant, as Judy said, and I walked the square several times and visited the nice little museum over there on the corner. I'm a New York City kid. I had never in my life been to a place like Hope, and I liked it immediately. Everybody was incredibly friendly, and it was a beautiful day, and it was a great place. But I must tell you, in all honesty, I'm an architect, and what I really, really responded to was this square. I liked it. I liked the buildings that defined it. I liked the sense of space. I actually liked the proportion of the square itself. It was open, like the countryside I had driven through to get here, not sort of tight like a European piazza. But it's based on the same notion of a European town square, which is that this is the basis of the community, and that space can represent community. And I was taken with the idea that the library board wanted to build the new branch library on the square and not out on a strip or in a shopping mall somewhere, because this is the center of the town, and the center of the town should be the center of community life. This is a space and a place, and it has a history, and in building a new public building here, it all becomes a continuation of that history and a part of that history. But what I responded to on a more specific level were that I liked the bricks of these buildings, I liked the patterns that the bricks made, I liked the awnings, I liked the rhythm of the buildings as they ran around the square and made the square a kind of outdoor room. And I thought that the new building needed to be a part of the pattern of the material and the scale of the square. Now, when you start to design a building, you meet with the people who have hired you and you talk to them about what they need, a place to read, a place to store books, a place for people who work there every day to actually do their work. windows, doors, bookshelves, and more bookshelves, and lights, and all that. But that's the easy part, and it might take a lot of meetings, but it's really just a list making. And after you leave them, you take the items on that list and you try to organize it in a way that might turn into space But once you have an organization, you then have to make sure that that organization is also a composition, and a careful composition. To use that old analogy, it's not just noise, but music that we were trying to compose here, if architecture is indeed frozen music. I believe that one of the ways to take the organizational diagram, this is my architectural philosophy, and make a beautiful composition is to look around you while you work. Work with what's there without slavishly imitating it, be respectful of scale and proportion and materials, and then know how to know when it's right to invent something new and bring in something new, like a light monitor, or a different approach to using wood, or classic proportions for openings than used in a modern composition. And that's what we did here. We worked very hard on the design of this building, and not only do I hope that you like it, I hope you use it often. I believe that the making of a building, or even more important, the making of architecture, is a collaboration. And within my office, many talented people contributed their energies to this project, including Stephanie Spoto, who worked on it in its early stages, and Stephen Brockman, who's here with me today and saw it through construction. We had the help of two wonderful consultants, our structural engineer Bob Silman, based in New York, and our mechanical engineers Tom Durkin and Fred Penley from BZ Parrot Shoulders in Evansville. Seco from Columbus were the surveyors, and as Judy said, the building was built by Rep and Munt, Fritz Keel at the helm, and Jay Crabtree as the project manager, and I think you'll see when you go inside that they really did a great job. Steve and Beth were an absolute delight to work with, responsive and responsible, and most importantly, the library board, both the current members and a few others whose terms expired over the course of this long project, and Helen Finke, who I miss very much. Her generous spirit helped me get to know Hope, along with Gladys, when we walked the square the very first time I came here. All these people deserve credit for this building, because although I might stand up here as the architect, we all did this as a team together. So please use this library, please enjoy it, please read books. And I guess if anyone else knows of another project for an architect on the square in Hope, let me know, because we'd like to come back. Thank you.
Thank you, Deborah. I think you'll find that we have much in common with our guest speaker, especially when it comes to library activity and interest in the library. He's considered a strong supporter and of public libraries, and we feel he's very committed to the future of libraries. Like us, he's a Bartholomew County resident, and he's a frequent user of the Bartholomew County Library, an avid reader, reading about an average of 4 books a month. That's real good, I feel. I get through a half of one a month, that'd be good. And by the way, we did a little check on this fellow, and we recently checked and found he has no overdue books or fines to be paid. So he sets a great example for the youth, as well as other citizens of Bartholomew County. But more importantly, he's been a true servant of the people for the past 28 years, not only in this community, but the entire state of Indiana. First elected to the Indiana State Senate back in 1970, re-elected to his 7th four-year term in 1994. He has served as president pro tem, and this is the top leadership post in the Senate. He served that particular position since 1980, the longest tenure in Indiana history. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to introduce to you the president pro tem of the Indiana State Senate, Robert Garton.
Thank you, Russ, and good afternoon. When Gladys Simmons wrote and asked if I would be the speaker, she mentioned that she wanted a red-hot speech, but this is ridiculous. We gather for just a couple hours here, June 28, 1998, moment in time, literally, to dedicate a building whose contents defy time. Libraries are literally the link of today to tomorrow and to yesterday. They do provide bridges to the past and stepping stones to the future. And then they offer a very quiet, a very gentle, a very restful environment for education, for entertainment, and together to plan community events. They exist to collect, to catalog, to protect, and to provide information. Regardless of its form, where it's printed words in a book, or it is software on the internet. The old saying, you learn to read, and then you read to learn. Barbara Tuchman, Pulitzer Prize winner, American historian, said, books are the corners of civilization. Without books, history is silent, literature dumb, science crippled, thought and speculation at a standstill. Without books, the development of civilization would be impossible. They are the engines of change, windows on the world, lighthouses, as the poet said, erected in the sea of time. And libraries have withstood and survived the sea of time. They are not only in tune with the times, they are timeless, because they provide opportunities to research, to relive the past, to review the present, and to read forecasts of the future. Literally, they are storehouses of information waiting to be shared. And so today, we dedicate Indiana's newest storehouse of information. 6,000 square feet, cost around $1 million, with the soft green carpet and the neutral colors and the all-wood ceiling created by Deborah to blend in to this environment. It's kind of appropriate, it seems to me, that we are in hope, because libraries signify and strengthen hope. You think about it, we write and record for now and then for those in the future. The very existence of libraries symbolizes our search for meaning and immortality. They are literally bridges to the past and stepping stones to the future. They have a very special role in the lives of citizens and communities. It's a neutral place for bringing together information and different ideas. And you can share that information without fear of coercion or intimidation. Further, they support time-tested values, and they stimulate visions for the future. After all, even Karl Marx said, books are, in one sense, the basis of all social progress. And then about a century later, Aldous Huxley observed that the proper study of mankind is books. We learn to read so we can read to learn. And there are times that others do not approve what may be available in libraries. It was over a century ago, a Catholic bishop in Denver, Colorado, Nicholas Motz, denounced library as, quote, sinks of corruption, unquote. That place where reach of the masses, he said, it was that place within the reach of the masses, the infidel teaching of Voltaire and other sensational dime store novels. And around 50 years later, though, the president of Yale, Deborah, Alfred Griswold said that books won't stay banned, they won't burn, ideas won't go to jail. Libraries will always exist. They are the levers we pull for freedom. Freedom of thought, expression, and assembly. The purpose of libraries, from clay tablets in ancient Mesopotamia 4,000 years ago to the central computer database in Columbus, Indiana. They're built to serve people of all ages, quietly, quickly, and conveniently. You see it here in this branch, where the circulation of children's materials is equal to the circulation of adult material. And we symbolize it at the front door, because that's where the children will be. It symbolizes information for all ages. So there's a very special significance to this ceremony. We dedicate a branch building that is more than bricks and beams and studs and sewer pipe. Had to work that in tonight. Ah, yeah, it's a shared dream. It's a shared dream for an informed tomorrow. It's an inspiration, and it is an identity. It signifies our ability to plan, to promote, to persist, and after 4 years, to build. A new public building, built without bonding, built with county funds that were managed by county people over the past 20 years. So we dedicate a building that adds to the quality of our life, reaffirms confidence in ourselves, and strengthens our identity with Hope, Indiana. It's on the square, and it's ready to serve. Because of Melville Dewey, who created the Dewey Decimal System, said, libraries, they exist to get the right books into the hands of the right people at the right time. And folks, that's what this branch is all about.
Concludes the formal portion of our activities this afternoon. A couple items I need to mention. You will find, as you tour the library, you'll find no books on the shelves. Books are to be moved in July the 13th. After the dedication, the library will be closed for a couple of weeks. The only books to be moved in at this time, as part of our dedication ceremonies, are the special memorial collection in memory of Helen Finke, who served on our board from 1987 to 1995. The Finke family will be taking part in the moving of these books here shortly. After a brief ribbon cutting, they will be moving the books into the library. Another reminder, refreshments at the rear of the tent after the conclusion of the ceremonies here. To conclude our ceremony, the Reverend Tim Dillingham, Assistant Pastor of the First Baptist Church, to give our benediction. Thank you.
Would you stand with me, please? May we bow. Oh God, bless this wonderful institution of knowledge, wisdom, and resource. You tell us that wisdom is better than gold, and to seek her as we would seek silver. May it be a center that promotes and assists in the acquiring of knowledge and wisdom for the people of this community. May it provide a world of dreams and opportunities through its service. God, you most of all know how powerful the spoken and written word are.
You tell us that knowledge is pleasant to the soul. Lord, we ask for your blessing upon the staff that will serve this community, and we praise you and thank you for those who saw this job to completion. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
We just lost the key, folks. We don't have any.
Is that it?
No.
No? Okay, now do it.
Thank you. I like your tie. Karen with the jeans on, I can't. Karen Brown's manager.
I knew them before that. The other knew it was. We are.
You're getting down. You can't get
These are a couple of our best customers, although I don't hardly recognize them because they've grown up.
With Hillary Bear, who's my sister, and we talked to the same customer. And we used to live like a half a block from the library. Now we'll have to walk a block.
Oh, poor baby. Yeah, yeah. Poor baby.
Okay. But we think we bought it maybe like the front door. All our way to the
Hey, neighbor. We'll see you. Thanks for coming.
You still over at R&E?
Okay, so we'll be able to, while they're doing whatever, we'll still have...